time she was here in Sydney at a World Cup, she was the captain of Sri Lanka, 1991. Scotland away against Sri Lanka.
Managed wing attack obstruction.
Pettit, nice straight ball through to McNeil.
I wonder if Joanne Pettit realises she's not the first famous Pettit to play goal attack on this court. Susan Pettit, playing for the New South Wales Swifts. Controversial admission from the Diamonds. It's good to see a Pettit out here at least.
Now Bibb's gone AWOL. Sri Lanka, can they answer straight away that first goal of Scotland? And that was a nice ball in from Alvis to Algama.
It's a good build-up. Algama really struggled to find space yesterday against Barbados, and she was dragged at quarter time for Hasita Mendes.
A good flick by June McNeil.
Instruction goalkeeper.
Scottish supporters radiant in their purple.
Scotland playing in their away strip today. Played in purple yesterday.
What is it about Scotland in purple?
Oh, funny you ask, Jen. I just always assumed it was to do with the thistle, but I found an interesting
Scotland
little story
area.
In the lead-up, which was that it was a bit of an accident.
Thank you.
Why Scotland play in purple. Now, the very first international game Scotland played was in England in the 47-48 season.
Contact.
And at that time, former Northumberland County Netball President Margaret Cassidy was trying to get international netball off the ground, and she organised the first ever international between Scotland and Essex and Scotland and England. And a few weeks prior to the game, Scotland didn't have a playing uniform. This woman, Margaret Cassidy, borrowed a uniform from Essex Netball, and its colour was purple. So Scotland decided to keep the purple as its registered national colours. They clearly thought it was meant to be, given
goal
the thistle is purple, Scotland's national emblem. And since then, they've always played in purple. Now, this blue of the... Now, apologies to any Scottish people listening. Saltai?
Yes, and I don't know either. I know that I can see it written down. I think it's the Saltair.
Yeah, now that blue was registered as their second or away colours. So there's still a bit of purple through this uniform. So it is interesting, Jen, when you look back at the historical sort of quirks as to why teams wear different colours and different uniforms, and I thought that was a cute little story.
It is. Meanwhile, Scotland add another 4-2. June McNeil, she's had a busy start at goal shoot. More advice in the ear of Joe Pettit. Oh, what a ball! Bethany Sutherland, not able to capitalise though.
Oh, Murphy, she has been everywhere on this court in the opening minutes of this game. Standing at just 167 centimetres tall, she's really fast and makes her a bit dangerous for Sri Lanka defensively.
Touch and goal defence, penalty, outside.
See, she matches up pretty well for height against the Sri Lankan wing attack, what they get her at. Murphy here. We often talk about a player's last step onto the ball, and that was a pretty good example of it. Really out of position until the last couple of steps, and that is what got her the tip.
Algama adds another.
Contact, wing in the centre third, please. Manage obstruction.
Oh, didn't see McNeil free on the baseline.
Gallagher was just watching outside the circle for Pettit. McNeil opened up. Oh, good parcel there.
Contact, goalkeeper, parcel shot.
Chance for Sri Lanka to hit the front. 5 minutes in, first quarter.
Well, unlucky Mulheron. She used the outside arm but just caught Algama with her shoulder on the way through. Oh, nearly. Mulheron read it really well. And that little defensive play is a real Kiwi style of defensive play where one of the defenders floats off and just looks to pick off the throw-in to the centre court on the edge of the circle. Katrina Grant, the Silver Ferns goal defence, is an absolute expert at it. And no surprises that with a Kiwi coach, there's a few little techniques in the Scottish game. And that's one of them. So just watch the next time Sri Lanka have a throw-in. Hayley Mulheron will start to float up towards the top of the circle where the centre court usually positioned, and she'll be looking for that intercept.
Disruption.
Oh, look at this. Sri Lanka, two-goal lead. As McNeil cuts it to one. Ball beats everyone. Scotland throwing. Now that's the way to get the ball down court. Forbes at goal defence today. Oh, strong rebound, McNeil.
Goal defence contact.
Gets it on the third attempt. Six all, just under 8 minutes left in the first quarter. This is a Pool H game. And as Liz mentioned, it's a bit of a tough pool. Barbados, Scotland, Sri Lanka, Fiji.
Well, really, almost every game at in these qualification pools are tough because based on the preliminary rounds, the teams have been split into the top eight and the bottom eight. So now you're in your qualification pools where the bottom eight has been split into two pools of four, and they're all really closely ranked. So we've been getting some ripping games in the last couple of days. Not the least of which was New Zealand Jamaica last night.
That was one of the best we've seen all week. So Jamaica absolutely taking it to the Kiwis. And it was really only in the latter part of the game that New Zealand found any true dominance.
Desenayake just so good on that goal defence position. In the losing team yesterday against Barbados, she finished up with 9 deflections and just long arms cause all sorts of havoc.
Oh, and you can see the disappointment on Pethagoda. She'd got the tip, but there was nobody there to pick it up for Sri Lanka. So it'll be a Scottish throw-in.
Bandage, obstruction, wing defence. Bandage offside, set up. Contact keeper, pass or shot. With her, please. Thank you.
Scotland back in front. A recon in the centre for Sri Lanka.
Well, Algama's having a fine opening quarter. 7 from 8.
Oh, what good work from Forbes, but it bounces Sri Lanka's way. Oh, Mulheron!
She worked hard for that, read it beautifully. Just just committed to it outside the circle. She was in no man's land, so she had to find the ball.
Oh, through the legs did that go? Whichever which way, it's come back down Sri Lanka's end.
What the getter is having a really great start in a wing attack. Shortest player on court.
Yes, Algama going over the top of Mulheron. She has a bit of space. Take that.
This is an interceptathon, Jen. It's fabulous netball.
Well, that ball from Sarika Gamagate, wing defence for Sri Lanka, that was terrific. But here we are again, back down the Scottish end.
Who needs shooters? We just all intercept all day. So who will settle first?
Here we go again. And Nayaka applaud, so she should. Goal defence for Sri Lanka.
Often when you get a passage of play like this where the ball goes from one end to the other a few times and it gets a little bit ratty, the team that settles first will then go on to score two or three goals in a row. And teams know that. You know that you want to be the team that just puts an end to the ratty play and just starts to go back to playing your structures, playing your basics.
Alves way down court. Nayaka again. So they're being held up here, Sri Lanka. Oh, dicing with 3 seconds, and yes, Scotland get their reward. You can't help but think you're missing a few opportunities into that circle, Scotland. McNeil makes no mistake with that one. Scotland 9-7. Oh, seem to have rocketed through this first quarter.
Well, it's been pretty entertaining, this end-to-end netball. Oh, McNeil, off the floor. She managed to have her feet on the floor, though.
Oh, nice skills from June McNeil.
June McNeil is their Scotland's fifth-ranked shooter. So they've got five shooters in their line, including Lindsay Gallagher, who's playing at wing attack. She spent some time at goal attack yesterday in a big win against Barbados.
I think that's right. When you think of the players who've gone through that shooting circle for Scotland, there are a number.
Good win there from Rachel Forbes, Brisbane-born. Talked yesterday about big one-handed shoulder pass that she's got that gives us her away as an Australian-born player.
Oh, what a pickup! Beautiful. Oh, Disanaka. She was out of court as she did so.
Well, you are goal attack.
She was to heel on the line or over the line.
Offside, wing defence, pass Scotland.
The umpire Gary Burgess all over it.
Offside, wing defence and obstruction.
There's a bare feed in. Murphy, the centre for Scotland, just limping back to the centre. Doesn't seem to be in too much trouble.
So a little run of goals here. Almost exactly what you predicted, Liz. Scotland scored first after that sort of messy run of play, and look what's happened now. Time call by Sri Lanka.
But often that happens because not so much if the team that scores first, you tend to settle quicker, that too. But also if you're the team that didn't score, you get your heads down a bit because you've just had to work so hard and the ball's come back down at you and it just takes a little while to get back up and going again. So that's a challenge now for Sri Lanka. They stuck with Scotland and that messy passage of play just cost them. It's cost them a few goals.
This is Alvis. Some ice applied to that knee. Her mother is the coach.
Bit bit of controversy around that selection. So there's plenty on the lines in these sort of games, Jen. Teams really want to be playing in the playoffs for 9th and 10th place. And so bodies on the line. Scotland have certainly come to play, as have Sri Lanka, and they're prepared to go out and do what it takes to get hold of the ball.
Lily Alva seems to be prepared. So 1.5 minutes remaining in the first quarter, 12-7. Scotland lead.
Wing defence.
Gamagay being told to stand down.
Barrage obstruction, wing defence. Barrage contact, obstruction. Contact.
Peter Goda got the tip.
Disanyaki stands at... Sorry, Disanyaka stands at 187 centimetres. Pethagoda is only marginally shorter. And I don't quite think that the Scottish front line have got their hands, got their minds around just how long their arms are. And Disanyaka in particular is getting lots of tips. Something that she's done with almost monotonous regularity in the last few days of this tournament. 4 deflections already in the first quarter. Just tends to put herself in the right space at the right time.
Another corner. Goes to the side. Omal Heron. Gosh, she attacks that ball. And she wins it for Scotland.
Causing shooter penalty. No goal.
Oh, so Jean McNeil gives away the penalty.
Oh, that was good presence of mind of Sri Lanka. They knew that there wasn't much time left on the clock, so it was worth the big heave down the court. But at the end of the first quarter, good second half of that quarter for Scotland, they lead Sri Lanka 14-7. So Scotland, I'll be relatively pleased with that first quarter.
But I'm on the ball, but I'm like, shit.
Even if you just call it, it's terrible later.
Yeah. Yeah.
Alright. Yeah. Plenty of chat on both benches. Here are the numbers.
Well, interesting that neither team is really hitting great heights in terms of their percentage. Scotland down at 64%, Sri Lanka at 70%, but it is the volume of shots that Scotland have had that are holding them in pretty good stead. 22 attempts to Sri Lanka's 10. They've both managed to get their hands on rebounds. Defensively, they're both doing a pretty good job. 3 intercepts apiece, and the intercepts for Sri Lanka, not surprisingly, have come through Disanyaka. She's got 2 intercepts and Gamage has 1. And if we look at Scotland's scorecard, 2 intercepts for Hayley Mulheron and 1 for Rachel Forbes. Scotland have moved the ball down the court pretty well, but it just looks to me a couple of times like they're just missing the final pass into the goal shooter. Their midcourt's looking away at the last second and not seeing it. And that's what we heard them talking about in that huddle. Make sure you keep looking at me. Make sure you wait until I appear. And it's a bit of a risk sometimes that you have to take as a midcourter. But it's well worth doing if your shooter finally opens up somewhere near the post. For Sri Lanka, Algama has been particularly impressive and in goal shooter. She has shot all of their goals, in fact, and Samini Alvis hasn't put up a shot at goal yet, but she does have 4 goal assists, so she's doing a pretty good job of moving the ball down into her shooting line. Algama really had a bit of a dog's day out yesterday against Barbados, didn't have much of the run of the ball, but today she's just enjoying the fact that she's got a height advantage over her opponent, Hayley Mulheron, of about 7 centimetres.
There's a couple of little changes I think here in the Scottish lineup. Moore McGrath coming on at wing attack. There she is. Just about set for the start of the second quarter. Both sides set for this second period of 15 minutes. 14-7, Scotland lead. And they'll have the first centre pass. Fiona Moore McGrath now on court. Far too much on that one from what they get it up. Likewise from Scotland, although they're very fortunate, it falls to them.
That looked very close to over a third. Ball must be touched in each third of the court as it goes down. Maybe Sutherland just had a couple of toes over the line. Get the impression that Scotland, Jen, knowing, coming into this game, knowing that they probably should win based on the results of both teams coming into this match. So they're running almost, not a second line, but they're just running and trying different combinations. And there's some players who we saw yesterday who were particularly impressive against Barbados who are being rewarded with a rest today. Well, it's funny when you're playing and you're playing well. Your coach has to manage your load, but you don't particularly like sitting on the bench.
Well, also, too, there's that thing, momentum, isn't there?
Yeah.
For combinations. Oh, just through their hands. The that's disappointing. But the Gedriga just couldn't hang on to it.
Gedriga just moving into centre. And oh, what's that? Coming on into wing attack. Saniyaka gets another win. Particularly impressive for Sri Lanka. We talked to the earlier game, Jen. Look, watching Lily Chen for Singapore, 197 centimetres, and you think to yourself, bit of work on their footwork and some of these players could be great, and I put Disaniyaka in that category. She's got a beautiful reach. Her footwork isn't bad for a tall player. I wonder if she was able to play netball consistently at a super high level, how good she could be.
Plenty of scouts in the crowd here, and Scotland Mulheron again comes away with it.
Well, there are, and the scouts aren't simply just for the ANZ Championship teams. There's scouts from the English Super League clubs who'd like to pick up some talent. New South Wales has a new Premier League that starts next year to replace the old State League. And coaches are currently building teams. I saw one of the coaches out here last night just having a look at some of the games.
But it's good to see, isn't it? Because, of course, yes, it's all about, you know, opportunities. But they really are, for some women from some of these countries, the opportunities are huge, life-changing.
Absolutely. And I guess the way that netball is set up in Australia is that the steps you have to take to make it into an ANZ Championship team. And let's face it, the ANZ Championship is the best netball league in the world. But the steps to get into a team are really clearly set out. There's a real pathway that's obvious. And for one of these players to come in somewhere through that pathway and on the midway point is a huge opportunity. And yes, it's a big risk. They've got to move. If they're coming midway through the pathway, there's not any money in it. They've got to come here and be prepared to work and find a job and uproot their entire lives. But it does present magnificent opportunities. And you can just see how proud Malawi are of Maui Kawenda and the role that she now plays in the ANZ Championship by the best new talent. And she came into the league.
And of course, certainly should be, because it's all very well for us English speakers to think, yes, you know, move country, that's all right. You know, English is everywhere. But from those countries where it's not, change of culture, change of language, change leaving your family, massive.
Well, we saw that with Romelda Aiken when she first moved to Australia to play for the Firebirds. And you look at her now and she sounds very Australian.
I noticed that last night listening to an interview.
You know what else? When the Queensland Firebirds won the ANZ Championship, Romelda ran along the sideline screaming, "Queenslander!" Which was perhaps one of the funnier things that I've seen in sport. Bad luck, Mulheron. She had really good rebounding position but couldn't quite control the pill.
Oh, sneaky little ball from Alvis. Oh, that's a heavy fall for Thorbs.
Play on, though. She popped the ball in the face. And just interesting that Sri Lanka have made that change in that shooting lineup with Mendes coming on. Defense. Given that Algama had such a great opening to the match, 7 from 10 at 70%. And Mendes sitting at 1 from 3. She was good yesterday against Barbados, Mendes.
So let's have a look at what's happened here. Watch Forbes. Oh, bang. What a... Oh, Jesus. Well, she is an Aussie. We know she'll be tough. But, gee, that would have hurt.
You also know that her friends are going to ring her up and say, "Nice Falcon," at the end of the game.
And so often with those, you get the black eyes as well if they're high enough on the nose.
So, no malice in it, but... She was close enough for that to really hurt.
She's lived in Scotland for a few years now, Rachel Forbes. She was also apparently in her earlier years a very good gymnast, had to make the choice between gymnastics and netball.
That's impressive.
It would help, wouldn't it?
Well, but they're not two sports to cross over. Often you find netballers are really great basketballers. There are some netballers who are great basketballers.
Athletes, sprinter-like runners.
Cheryl McMahon could have gone one of two ways in her career. Fell on a hurdle, Jen, in state championships, fell over a hurdle, leading the state champion. Had she won that match or had she won that race, may very well have been a hurdler. But she lost the race, went to netball.
Well, perhaps we should be grateful to that hurdle.
That's right.
I don't know that New Zealand should be.
I was going to say, I'm pretty sure some Kiwis have been suggesting the hurdle wasn't quite high enough.
I'm using "we" as the netball rule.
Oh, the royal "we." But gymnastics and netball are not two sports that tend to go hand in hand when athletes have to make choices. I'll tell you another one. Shani Layton had to make a choice between netball and equestrian.
Ah, Tanya Dalton had to make a choice between netball and tennis.
Oh, there's people who are good at two sports. Annoying. I've just been told that our boss at Fox Sports, Keely Devery, had to choose between netball and basketball. I think she talks up her basketball career a little bit too much.
Well, of course, there were the New Zealanders who did both.
Belinda well, that Colling. Is true. Belinda Colling, Donald O'Fagan. They both represented in the Olympics in Sydney, didn't they?
They did. Anyway, while all this gavel has gone on, Scotland has pulled out to a 28 lead. Now we've just got Alvis again going to the sideline. We saw her go, and in fact now it's her shooting partner this time, Mendes.
Scotland leads 6-1 in this quarter, and it's a much poorer start from Sri Lanka. They had a good start in the first quarter and not so good in the second quarter, and you do wonder if the change will be made between Mendes and Algama. because that change simply has not worked.
And yes, due to largely a lot of it, that woman front facing you, Hayley Mulheron, the captain, goalkeeper, she's been so strong.
Well, in bringing on Mendes, have actually played into Mulheron's strength, which is her ability to work the ground and have a good, strong go at the ball, whereas Algama just has that extra height and reach. And it's a surprise that she was subbed off in the first place, and Sri Lanka figured that out, and she's back on. So Mulheron knows that she's got to change her game plan again. She's got against a much taller player.
8.5 minutes remaining in the second quarter. 20-8, Scotland lead. So let's see what this change, difference it makes.
You can also see with Scotland through this second quarter, they're really looking in to try and get the ball as soon as they can into the circle. In that first quarter, they tended to work around a little bit. But clearly, Galbrata, the Scottish coach, has said, look in. And
how was that for a steal?
What the getter up. Just flies through the air. She's done that a few times this game. Great speed.
And look at her go. She's powerful little player.
If you watch what the... Oh, Mulheron, beautifully done. Dangerous play when you come out of the circle and take that risk, but she flicked the ball away.
Another Vunsa at wing attack. Nice hands and the step in. Can't convert. So nothing going right for Sri Lanka, really, in this second quarter. We're on the halfway mark, just the one goal.
So that was a long-range shot from Algama, and if you look at her shooting stats, she shot 53 goals for this tournament, 48 of which have been from close range, just the 5 shots at long range of 55%. So that's an uncomfortable shooting position for her to be in the outside half of the circle. And Sri Lanka would do well just to have an extra couple of passes just to get her closer to the post.
Drew McNeil doing good work on those rebound tips for Scotland. It's a high shot. Here's Disanaka. She'd done the work to get the ball. Pettit's contact.
Disanaka had a really good jump at the ball then. She was a little bit too soon, but it was enough to get into the eye line of Pettit and put her off a shot. Ah, oh, Forbes, great pick up.
Let's take a look at this. June McNeil scores, but this is what happened in the play earlier.
Wing attack, you need to come straight off.
I think her ear is still there. And now look, this is Amara Vunsa.
Blood call.
You need to change.
Oh no, she's called time, so they've got 30 seconds to make a straight change. So it's a second time out for them in this quarter, which means that they have to change the player who called time. She must come off the court.
So what the getterer goes back to wing attack, and we've got a new player at centre. There she is. Oh, Abercorn comes back.
God is breaking.
Alvis.
She was out of court, Algama. She made a couple of nice moves, but Forbes had it covered.
Contact, wing attack.
Take the ball when you're out of court.
Sometimes, I guess, which under such intense pressure like that, you can lose. Oh, how fortunate for Sri Lanka.
Yeah, you can lose sense of where you are on court, and the great players just know it without even thinking about it.
Scotland throw.
And it's good defence when you can force players off court. The only problem is, from a defensive point of view, is you can't run off court with them. You must stay on court. Lazy take there from Murphy. She'd done all the right things, got herself into a really good position in the pocket, but just went up with one hand.
What an attack on the ball from Moore McGrath. I think for a moment thought that she'd got and made that ball go off the Sri Lankan player. Not so.
Full court press here from Scotland. Let's see how Sri Lanka do getting through it. And the press does its job. So just to explain, a full court press is very Kiwi style of defence, and it's when players pick a space to defend rather than a player. And it's a difficult thing to get through because it's hard to pick where you need, A, where you need to run, and B, where the ball needs to go. And anything cross-court or long is fair pickings for the defensive team.
Eighteen turnovers for Sri Lanka. Yeah, costly. McNeil trying to convince the umpire. It might have been hers. I think there's the setup again, Liz.
Yeah, you can see the players with their arms up, just trying to take up even more space. So the difficulty in playing a zone defence when you haven't grown up with it is that it's easy to set it up. Your coach can tell you exactly where you need to stand. As Sri Lanka come through that beautifully. The difficulty is knowing what balls to commit to and knowing what balls to leave. And just sense that Scotland are just in that process at the moment. With great defensive pressure from Mulheron.
Obstruction, boys.
Yeah, nice delivery from Moore McGrath. She saw that McNeil had put the screen on for Pettit. Yeah, just a nice high delivery.
Well, Sri Lanka still just the one goal in this quarter. We've only got 3.5 minutes left. Certainly not for want of trying. The getter got forced to go back. There it is. Goal number two.
Body subtraction centre. Body subtraction wing defence.
And there's the contrast in this game. How quickly Scotland score and as just, opposed to Sri Lanka.
Yeah, and just how well the space has opened up for the Scottish team. If you look at the Sri Lankan style of play, they've got a tall holding goal shooter in Algama. So you need a goal attacker who's prepared to drive, but Alvis has simply stopped driving. She wants to sit out here as a third feeder almost. She must get in and split the Scottish defenders. When she does it, it works. So she's got there to the edge of the circle, so Forbes had to come off onto her, and that's what opened up Algama. So Alvis has to do a heap more work in there.
That is Alvis's first goal. Too much on that one from Pettit.
Third.
Joe Pettit actually is another one who's obviously very skillful at many sports. She used to swim at national level.
Contact, wind defence, bandage offside. Contact centre.
Oh. Murphy, it's gone down. She's unhappy.
Time injury centre, Scotland.
Just a minute remaining in the second quarter.
It's a heavy fall. Directing the physio, it looks to her ankle.
Let's have a look, see if we can see what happened. She had her leg across, and I think the player just, well, came through it. Looked awkward.
She was already standing. Oh, it might be a corky.
Now, for those in the audience who aren't Australians, corky?
Isn't that a universal term?
I don't think so. I think it's one of yours alone.
What do you call something when you get a really hard blow to your muscle?
I don't know that we have a word.
Oh, stop it.
No, seriously.
You must. So a corked muscle.
Right.
So it's when you get... It often happens when you get someone's knee into it, like a soft tissue or an elbow. Kath Cox had a corky once that calcified. I know. It was almost like she had like a little sister growing out of a leg.
Well, Murphy is heading to the sideline.
She was walking with a limp earlier in the match, but didn't seem to bother up. I think she's got a bit of a hard hit to that calf muscle.
Oh, Mulheron, yeah, saw that coming.
Gee, she's playing well, Mulheron. That's her third intercept of the match.
So on comes Claire Brownie at centre.
She was one of the stars yesterday for Scotland.
Oh, Brownie, she has a real presence on court, Brownie. There she is, straight away. That hand through with the tip.
Stepping, McNeil. Little fancy, got up in the air and had nowhere to go. And it was only a split second, but the umpire was all over it.
Sri Lanka, what can they eke out of this last few seconds? I'll be disappointed with that. There's the thinking of Brownie. Oh, McNeil probably should have shot it because they have run out of time. But another strong quarter from Scotland. They have held Sri Lanka to just 4 goals. So at the halftime break, it is Scotland leading Sri Lanka 25-11. Strong huddle from the Thistles, and here is Sri Lanka.
So wholesale changes for Scotland. Thiemann, another Australian. Hang on. No, that's wrong. Gemma Soule is the goal shooter. Coming on for Scotland. Coming for a wing attack. Pettit at goal attack. Brownie stays in at centre. Thiemann on at goal defence. Kim McNeil has gone to goalkeeper. And Claire Brownie at wing defence. Fiona Moore-McGrath in at centre. Beautifully read by Thiemann. Strong drive down court.
I think Sri Lanka staying pretty much as they were.
Jaya Saria on at wing defence.
Very similar build to Disanaka. Long limbs.
Good to see that Sri Lanka, they haven't fiddled around with that shooting circle. They really need to be told to get out there, keep working it. Alvis has got to keep taking that front drive.
Reset. Move it off.
Saw Gemma Soule come onto the court yesterday playing the bagpipes.
Just shows that she too is multi-talented.
Yes, talked about netball athletes playing other sports, haven't quite got to their musical abilities yet. That was impressive.
June McNeil making her presence felt at the other end of the court. Should imagine the bagpipes with something you'd be needing an awful lot of coordination for.
Well, and a pretty impressive heart-lung capacity. McNeil showing she's adept at the other end of the court. You don't often see players go from goal shooter to goalkeeper in a game. We saw Trinidad players today go from centre to goal defence and remarked about what an unusual move that is. Bit of a jump there from Petha Goda, but it wasn't enough. Put Pettit off a shot.
Van is breaking. Goal shooter.
Now Sri Lanka reached the circle.
Oh,
that's one pass too many.
Yep. Every time you pass the ball, you give the defenders a chance to intercept it. So the fewer passes, the better. But that what time it comes off for Sri Lanka. Oh, that was a nice pass, but well read.
Big slap from Gallagher. Marker, trying to find someone. The Getterer comes to her aid. Now back with Tsunaka. Well, that was a little bit of a heave and hope. And it ends up in the hands of Scotland.
Contact, keeper, pass the shot.
Jenna Soul from a very strong sporting background. Her father was a very fine rugby player. Played for the Lions. He was the captain of Scotland for a number of years. I think the brothers are pretty good cricketers and rugby players. Brownie looks at the umpires of to say, you've got to be joking.
Well, Scotland had a pretty comprehensive warm-up into this World Cup tournament. They spent a little bit of time in Tasmania and they played some practice matches, and really the form that they showed in those practice matches wasn't a particularly good pointer to the form that they're showing here at the moment. They lost by 6 goals to Tassie Spirit, which is, I guess, one of their development teams, and they lost to the Australian Centre of Excellence team, which is a young player, a team of young players based out of the Australian Institute of Sport. And they lost that game 57-26, and then lost to Wales 45-36. But sometimes pre-tournament matches aren't an accurate pointer to how you're going, because Scotland have been super impressive in a couple of games that I've seen them play. Their defensive and attacking structures are good. They let the ball go. They play with authority.
Contact with the penalty.
So I'm really looking forward to seeing how the playoff component of this tournament goes with the teams ranked 9 through to 16, because there's some really good teams sitting there or thereabouts.
Just speaking of Wales, they're having a reasonable tournament. They have made their way through to the top eight.
So they placed ninth at the last World Cup, Wales. So already guaranteed of going better than that. And Jen, it seems like with the Commonwealth Games last year in Glasgow, extra funding got pumped into Scottish netball, and you can really see the results. Welsh netball have really reaped the rewards as well. And the Welsh netball team basically play in the English Super League as the Celtic Dragons. So you can see that time together, when they come to a tournament like this, they really know each other's game inside out, and you can just see the results of it. There's been some talk around maybe revamping the ANZ Championship, and one of the proposals that has come in is maybe a team from Singapore.
Gosh,
I don't know how serious that's been taken,
but it's a challenge.
Certainly something that's been talked about sort of in this stage at the moment.
Would that be like an international team based in Singapore?
Well, I don't know that enough work's been done on it, but there's ANZ Championships are going through a bit of a review, and when people hear that there's a review on, all sorts of ideas come out, and the Singapore idea was flooded. I don't know how much Kate Palmer thought of it, Netball Australia's CEO.
Well, there's nothing wrong with reviews, because if you keep doing the same old thing...
That's right, there's nothing wrong with just ideas being thrown around, and I don't mind that idea.
Manage structure.
Straight into the hands of Claire Brownie. Gemma Soule adds another for Scotland. 34-15. Nice work from McNeil.
I think McNeil looks far more comfortable in goalkeeper than she did in goal shooter. She reads the game really well. She commits to it. Nice little turn of speed.
So I always think she looks a very committed player wherever she is on court. Concentration is complete.
Spit on the land from Sol. Herself a little bit closer, but Pethigata was up for the rebound. It's the second rebound of the match.
Contact, wing attack.
Pethigata and goal defence.
Wing attack, you're impeding play. Sonyaka.
He's worked incredibly hard today.
Goalkeeper with her.
Not to get a report with nowhere to go but backwards. And here she is again. Bit of a live wire, this wing attack for Sri Lanka.
Yeah, she's certainly not intimidated by the fact that she gives away centimetres to her opponents.
Algama just turns around and smiles at whoever threw that pass way over the head of even her.
Well, it was Abby Kuhn that threw it, and every time Sri Lanka try and force the ball long into Algama, the ball gets picked off by the Scottish defence. So they need to learn that lesson. When they play short and sharp is when they're successful. Having said that, though, it's already an improved quarter for them. They scored just four in the second quarter, have scored five already. 6 minutes to go, just over 6 minutes to go in the third.
That is contact, wing defence.
Oh, nice delivery there from Moore McGrath. Just looked past the mess that was in front of her. Found Sol on the drive to the post.
On the Scottish bench, the figure of Leslie MacDonald between the officials.
Contact
she has 129 tests to her name. Incredible feat. Doesn't look as though she's taking part today, though. That just shows the competitiveness in this game. 5 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Beeman says, thank you very much.
Yeah, that was really good eyes then from McNeil. She read it. It was cross-court and high, and she was going for it. But saw that Beeman had it and decided to pull out. You don't want to hurt yourself or each other at this point of the tournament when there's some pretty important matches coming up, especially looking towards the weekend.
Who's going to get it? Brownie, as it turns out. Disanayaka.
She's so dangerous just because of the reach that she's got. So she's tall anyway, but great long arms. She's been incredibly disruptive.
With her shooter,
so we've got another of these passages of play where it's going from one end of the court to the other.
Oh, that's a better ball. Lovely move from Algama. Can she finish it? No. So who will settle first? Scotland settled the last time this happened. This ratty sort of play happened.
Contact goal, wing defence. Party centre offside.
Once again, it is the Thistles. 37-17, they open up a 20-goal lead. Sri Lanka have another tough agenda tomorrow. They play Barbados.
Alvis. Much easier build up for Sri Lanka at goal.
Nice move from Scotland.
Gerda,
definite about the rebound.
Causing wing defence.
It's against Brownie. Saw it. Wasn't a bad idea in terms of a pass. Oh, nice touch there from Alvis. Can they finish it? So, two in a row for Sri Lanka. This is their highest quarter score so far, but they blow that one.
Stop from Scotland. Ball screaming down the sideline. A nice change of pace. Sign of maturity. Ah, beautiful ball. That was a really nice build-up from Scotland. Should have been finished. Pettit can do the honours. She can. But in that build-up, Scotland were coming down that sideline at speed, and it was just nice maturity for them to stop, change the pace, look for a second option. And as a result, they maintain possession.
So late run in this quarter from Scotland as they add another. As they do so, 15-8 in this quarter. So in fact, it's the most goals scored of any quarter in this match. I expect this to be the last act of the third quarter. As Sri Lanka adds another, and there is the whistle for the end of the third period of play. 20 goals between these two sides. Scotland leading Sri Lanka as they have all game, 40 goals to 20. All better scoring by both sides. You can see Gail Parata there having things to say with her team.
I don't know.
So plenty of instructions coming from the Sri Lankan bench. We just have a look at the stats. You can just see the mountain of possession that Scotland have had. 58 attempts at goal, 31 to Sri Lanka. I think both teams are a bit disappointed, though, with their accuracy on goal, both in the 60s. If you want to progress through this tournament, you've got to start lifting your accuracy up into the early to mid-80s at the very least. As a result, there's been plenty of rebounds available on offer for both teams, and they've certainly made the most of them. 8 for Scotland, 5 for Sri Lanka. And if we just have a quick look through the scorecard of each one, a good entry to the game from Gemma Sol. She's shot 11 from 14 at 79% to be the best performed shooter on court when you add up her volume and her accuracy. Alvis for the goal attack for Sri Lanka is sitting at 100%, but has just had 3 shots in 3 quarters. Agama, the best performer from the Sri Lankans at 16 from 23 at 70%. Just get the sense that Sri Lanka came out firing a little bit in that quarter. Just the 4 goals in the second quarter, scored 5 more goals, so more than doubled their return in that third quarter. Defensively, though, they let Scotland into the game a little bit more, but that's just as much as a result, I think, of Gemma Sol coming into the game and replacing June McNeil in that goal shooter position. Sol just making the most of every opportunity that she got, and she was readily available for the Scots on that baseline.
And great pictures there showing the intensity of this match. So much to play for these teams, world rankings. They're in Pool H along with Barbados and Fiji. Both sides get their marching orders ahead of the fourth and final quarter. Sri Lanka trail by 20. Scotland will have the centre pass for the fourth quarter. Claire Brownie awaits the ball. And here it comes. Final quarter underway. Scotland in the blue, leading Sri Lanka 40 goals to 20. Now we see June McNeil back down in the shooting circle.
Gemma Sol moved out to goal attack. Midcourt remains unchanged. Sutherland back in at wing defence. Hayley Mulheron on at goal defence. And Thiemann back at goalkeeper. And a change for Sri Lanka. Gamagi coming in at wing defence for them. So Jay Saria goes to the bench.
Scotland, go in.
Scotland just taking the opportunity while they've got a handy lead just to tinker with some combinations. They're trying to run their top line. That seems to be about sharing the load.
Oh, Gemma Sol got herself all tangled up. In the end, the call was stepping.
Oh, Brownie, that was great work. Couldn't quite control it back to her own teammate, but controlled the ball with one hand.
Outside arm, Thiemann.
That's it.
Unlike Rachel Forbes, who's been living in Scotland for a number of years, Fiona Thiemann went across to Scotland last year with the intent of trying to make the Scottish team for the Commonwealth Games. She qualifies courtesy of her late father, who was a Scot.
I can feel netballers all over Australia checking their parents' passports. In New Zealand.
Any this break, wing defence.
You know, Jim, we've talked about what great opportunities there are for athletes from developing countries to come to maybe Australia or New Zealand and play up through the leagues with the aim of making an ANZ Championship team. But netball does offer the same almost reciprocal opportunities to athletes who may be very close to making it in the top flight in Australia, but not quite, and go and play for another country and come back and play in a World Cup. So what a magnificent opportunity for Thiemann. Family are watching and loving it.
There's a few players around, aren't there, who I'm thinking of more particularly Juliana Naupu, obviously never played for New Zealand, but was very close to it. She's here in Sydney playing for Samoa.
She was, of course, one of the stars for Magic when they won their one and only title as Thiemann comes through to take the ball
Sri Lanka.
Back in 2012.
And then dogged by knee injuries. Never able to regain that beautiful form.
No, outside.
Here, just beautiful timing from the skipper. I wonder what these various combinations going on in the Scottish shooting circle. I wonder if Leslie McDonald is perhaps carrying an injury. She's clearly taking no part today.
Well, she doesn't look like she's thinking about playing. She's not sitting down the players' end of the bench.
She's got track pants on.
I hope she's okay. She was good yesterday against Barbados.
Was revered, I think, as the queen of netball in Scotland.
Beautiful. Algama, it's her 19th shot for the match. On the bench.
Contact, keep it, pass it.
From McNeil, an incredible vertical jump. And she couldn't control that to herself, so he just dished it off to Sol. Oh, that's good vision. Great end-to-end netball.
I've noticed about June McNeil, if she isn't actually taking the ball, she is talking. Great communicator. Always talking to the shooter in the circle with her or her feeders on the outside. Imagine Sonia McCloma marking her.
I was thinking, imagine Charlie Layton marking
her. There'd be a lot of chat.
Not a lot of sense, but a lot of chat. So the key for Scotland now, they're in well and truly in control of this game. But given they've got some big matches coming up, they need to just continue to push through, not allow themselves to get sloppy, not start to take risks defensively make sure that in attack they're not just content to try and throw speculators. They've got to still continue to work the ball down court. And sometimes that's tough to do when you've played really well. And that's one of those passes that I was talking about. And Moore McGrath really should have just steadied her feet and taken the opportunity just to get used to changing the pace, slowing things down, retaining control. Defensively, Scotland are still working hard.
Well, Garma right down just about as far as she can go.
Wing area, outside.
Sri Lanka throwing.
Structured hold, goalkeeper.
Scotland move through to 50. Exactly twice Sri Lanka's score. 50-25. 6.5 minutes left in the game. A lot more netball to come today here on day six.
Scotland.
Samoa, Zambia, England, Wales, New Zealand, Malawi. That's always an entertaining contest. And then Australia, South Africa. Africa trying to work their way up the rankings like everyone else here. They hit a bit of an Australian roadblock tonight.
I reckon they'll have a few tricks up their sleeve. Norma Plummer will have had a really good look at the Australian videos, and that's one thing that Norma Plummer does incredibly well, and that's why I think it would be incredibly difficult to be a head coach, is to have the discipline to watch video after video after video. And she really does pick the opposition team apart, and so she would have done that with the Diamonds, and she'll want to go into the game tonight with just a few little surprises for her old charges. She knows them incredibly well.
Interesting thing about the New Zealand-Malawi game tonight is that they are the two unbeaten teams in the tournament.
Well, and Malawi, if you look at the scoring levels, have been dominant. They're the only team so far in this tournament to hit a ton. And you look at the seedings, you think, well, New Zealand should win. It's like Australia should win against South Africa. But there's enough surprises in this tournament, I think, and enough
contact
surprises really coming out of Africa that, as an Australian fan and as a Kiwi fan, I'm pretty nervous.
Yes, you look back at the history of Malawi and New Zealand games, and I think they've only played each other seven times, and early on, you know, the margins were big. Well, not really anymore.
Well, there was 3 goals in it, wasn't there, at the Commonwealth Games?
Yes, I wasn't going to mention that one.
Well, that's...
But no, it's a credit to Malawi, and, you know, again, we talk about this. I marvel at how they achieve it, actually, on the resources they have.
Absolutely.
And I think to give credit to the World Netball body, I think they get help. And it's to be applauded.
They do. And when Malawi first came into World Netball in 1995 at that World Cup, they didn't have enough balls for everyone to do the warm-up properly, and they danced for their warm-up, and it was the best thing. It was fabulous.
Oh, Gemma Salt does well. Holds the balance and adds one more to the Scottish total.
Gemma Sol, she's unorthodox looking in the way she plays the game. And I'm not sure it's because she's a left-handed shooter. Just, you don't see too many of them. And she looks like she's going over balance, but she tends to steady herself. She's been good for Scotland.
As she adds one more, 55-25. The margin extended to 30 goals.
Salt, best performed with the Scottish shooters, 23 from 28 at 82%.
Bandage breaking, wing defense.
Only one of the goal shooters and goal attacks on court to be sitting in the 80s. So you would expect to see her beaming up for Scotland when they head into their playoff games later in the week.
With her centre.
Went one way, thought better of it.
Yeah, and then she really wanted to follow the ball, but what she needed to do was just run into the circle to take some of the pressure off Algami.
Well, it's been a long time between drinks for Sri Lanka in this final quarter. They add another. June McNeil uses her defensive skills. Day at the office, June McNeil. Played both ends of the courts, of the court rather, 20 from 29.
Yep. Don't often see a goal shooter with an intercept and nine deflections, but it's courtesy of the time she spent at goalkeeper.
Nice ball finding Algama just on the baseline. Nicely saved by McNeil. Big ball from Sutherland. Sri Lanka doing what they could to finish with a flourish. But it is full time. Smiles all round. Sri Lanka still left bereft without a win. Scotland add another. They take the game 59-27.